All right, good morning, good morning. Let's get started for the day, everybody. I'd like to start with an introduction. This is really hard without saying the person's name, so I'll do my best. All right, so I met our next speaker on a beach in Cape Cod during an MIT retreat when the department was recruiting her. I remember feeling like I was sitting next to an idea generator, like a kind of walking encyclopedia of ideas. Whether it was about the culture of science labs or about science itself, she had an endless repository of ideas concerning what's right, what's wrong, and what could be better in science. In her own words from her lab website, my top priority is that people in the lab are happy and stay happy. It really is that simple, and yet it takes a force of nature to make that happen. So I think we all know that science can be a contact sport and everyone should be a team player. When talking about her career at that day on the beach, it stood out to me that she listed all her previous mentors and collaborators and mentioned how they influenced her work and approached the field. I found it admirable, not just that she knew who her core team was, but that she could really concretely verbalize how they helped her, because it meant that her approach to mentoring would also be just as concrete. I reached out to a handful of people in her lab to see, just to get a couple of sentiments, and it was amazing. I mean, one of the lab members said, "She's someone who speaks truth to power and goes above and beyond to advocate for her trainees. She nurtures scientific confidence by encouraging her trainees to be independent and risky in designing and conducting experiments. No matter how wild the idea might be, she has the leadership skills to guide her trainees towards bringing their ideas to fruition in the end. She makes the time whenever someone reaches out for mentorship and effectively trains all of us for the next step in our careers, no matter what those steps may be." I think, to use another quote, there's a quote from Parks and Rec where Ron Swanson says never to half-ass something, but to whole-ass it. And I think our speaker today runs with the latter approach with regards to her work and just philosophy of science. Right? Leadership really does begin from above, and she does walk the walk. When we overlapped at MIT, for instance, I'd go to her in chat, and every meeting somehow ended with something actionable that she'd be part of, that she would be part of if it could help. As a PI now, I really appreciate how much effort that actually takes and then how much care and TLC that takes. So for instance, I used to run the recruitment parties for graduate students at MIT, and this person wouldn't just encourage me to throw a good party, but would send emails and literally walk around the department to get other PIs in the labs to join too. She's a hands-on community builder, and this proactive approach really has influenced how I approach being a PI as well, so thank you for that. I didn't realize it at the moment on the beach, and despite all the awards and accolades and very prestigious titles that she's earned, perhaps the most meaningful ability that I really do want to point out is that talking to her when I was a grad student, it genuinely made me feel safe, seen, and valued. That's not just the sign of a good PI, but the sign of a good person, and ultimately someone who would become a good friend, and I'm really grateful for that. So everybody, please help me in welcoming Kay Tai.
Good morning, everyone. It's so exciting to be here at my very first Learning in Memory. And that was a wonderful introduction. Thank you so much, Steve. I think that was my favorite intro ever. I want to thank Mike Yassa for putting together this incredible meeting and for you guys for waking up so early. It was hard for me, too. Okay, so today I'm going to be digging back into the archives, but showing a thread that's really kind of woven its way through not only recent years, but my entire career. So this goes all the way back to graduate school and goes all the way through the future, and it's a mystery yet unsolved. Some stimuli have innate emotional valence. No training or learning is required to have emotional responses to them. Other stimuli are initially neutral, unless paired with an emotionally significant outcome. In my field, there's been a lot of controversy regarding whether people, humans, and animals experience emotion in the same or different ways. But there's no way for me to really know how an animal experiences emotion or whether that is the same or different from how a human does. There's also no way for me to know whether another person would experience emotion the same way that I do. It's subjective. And so even though what I'm really passionate about is understanding internal state, what I'm going to make claims about and talk about today are motivated behaviors and learning and memory. So the big question that has, you know, kind of been the North Star for most of my career is, how do we assign valence to sensory stimuli? Take, for example, a track star and a war veteran. They both hear a gunshot. Maybe the track star thinks about all his gold medals that he's going to win. There's excitement. There's anticipation. Maybe the war veteran is filled with panic and fear. Also, imagine a condition where you hear this gunshot sound over and over and over and nothing of consequence happens. And then you're just kind of bored. And this is really this phenomenon is just sort of illustrating the two-dimensional theory of emotion. So when we think about on this axis, the two-dimensional theory of motion just implies that if something's good or bad, then it's going to be intense. And if it's neither good nor bad, then it's not. Not to confuse you, but there's another theory I want to point out, which is more about the order of operations, the two-factor theory of emotion. And so this proposes that when we navigate the world around us, we are bombarded with sensory stimuli. There's a barrage of sensory stimuli that's constantly coming out, but we're ignoring a lot of it. And we ask ourselves, what is important? You can think of that as almost like absolute value. If it's not important, then it's neutral. And if it is important, then we have to ask ourselves another question. Is it good or bad? If it's bad, we want to avoid it. It's negative valence. If it's good, we want to approach it, positive valence. This is the fork in the road that I want to talk about today. How does this happen? And what does it look like when it actually happens? Okay. And so I want to highlight why this is so important. Why am I so obsessed with valence? Well, any perturbation of valence can be really expressed in a lot of different mood disorders. For example, the normal healthy brain has a balance of motivation to avoid potential negative consequences and seek rewards. But an anxiety patient might have an imbalance of too much motivation to avoid potential negative consequences, not enough to seek rewards, and vice versa might be true for someone with a substance use disorder, where they might seek rewards more than they can avoid potential negative consequences. And someone with depression might just have a flattening of affect overall. And so this is obviously a very simplistic illustration, but just to show you how important valence processing is for everything. And so how is this implemented? So a few years back, I wrote a review trying to think about all the pieces of information that we have. There's so many studies, even more now, of course, but so many studies reporting valence processing in different circuits. And what can we learn about the implementational biology to understand, you know, the higher level computation? And so the simplest possible motif is this idea of labeled lines. And the Zucker lab published a paper that's really showing, for example, that in gustatory cortex, bitter maps onto negative valence and sweet maps onto neurons in the amygdala that code for positive valence. And it's just that simple. It's labeled lines. It makes sense for something that's innate valence. You know, it should be hardwired in there that you avoid poisons and stuff like that. But this doesn't explain how we can have plasticity. How can I learn to like bitter tastings like coffee or beer? So labeled lines is not really what we're interested in. We're interested in motifs that allow for flexible learning. For example, stimulus information comes in, and then there are multiple paths that then, you know, activate different downstream targets. And I'm going to talk about that a little bit today. Divergent paths is a motif we see a lot. Another motif that I won't get into today, but you see it all the time, is that there are different inputs that are converging onto a common source, and then that downstream source needs to integrate sort of conflicting information to sort of be the gas or brakes. And so my first graduate student Edward Nia showed that lateral hypothalamic glutamate and GABA neurons going to the VTA can kind of act like gas or brakes onto the VTA, which of course we know to be able to broadly modulate behavior and downstream circuits. And then the most elusive one, which I am also going to talk about a lot today, is this motif of neuromodulatory gain. The power of this motif is that not only can you have one signal that sort of sends very different neurons downstream will respond differently, but also we're smearing out that time scale so that we can kind of connect things that are behaviorally relevant. Because one of the biggest irks of mine that I've lost so much sleep over in the past decades is that the cellular basis of memory is, you know, things that occur on tens of milliseconds, hundreds of milliseconds, not on the seconds or minutes that we actually, you know, behave in and that are relevant. Okay, so I'll talk about that a little bit more too. So this will be the focus for today, these two motifs, and they're actually not mutually exclusive. And so we've already heard a lot about the amygdala from Sheena Jocelyn's beautiful talk yesterday. But we've known for over 100 years that the amygdala is important for emotional processing of environmental stimuli, first from Brown and Schaefer, from temporal lobectomies, then Kluver and Busey, who coined this term psychic blindness for monkeys that would play with light bulbs and feces and food and plastic snakes all the same and lost their sort of emotional responses to these stimuli, and then narrowed down to the amygdala by Larry Weisskranz in 1956. Really important case study patient SM had bilateral lesions in the amygdala and was unable to recognize emotion in people's faces, lost the fear to snakes and spiders, and even being mugged and was mugged several times in her life. But when being asphyxiated with low oxygen, was able to trigger the sort of panic response associated with that. So that tells us the amygdala is not necessary for the autonomic response. It's necessary for recognizing and interpreting the world to trigger that response. Or at least that's how I'm thinking about it. So we all know that associative memories of both valences are stored in the lateral amygdala and basolateral amygdala. And many people, including Sheena Jocelyn, who I've cited here, and many others have helped us to know this. And so back to the North Star. And really the North Star for me has been these very related questions. One, where is valence being processed? Where is this fork in the road? Where did the train tracks split? Two, how is valence expressed? What does it look like when the trains are actually running and, you know, sometimes the tracks are being switched? And then, honestly, the most challenging question is, how is valence assigned? When we think about the credit assignment problem, the credit assignment problem is this classic age-old problem about how do we associate salient things and things that predict them when so many stimuli are being presented to us all the time. And the valence assignment problem is even more challenging because, you know, a stimulus could be presented. We don't know what's going to happen next. Something could happen next that's minutes or seconds away. And how do we connect those two things? And so this is more a question about who is the switch operator running these two railroad systems? Who is the signal that switches whether it's good or bad and where the trains run, so to speak? So I like to think the amygdala has 13 different subnuclei, but I'm going to focus on the basolateral amygdala. But really, I think of the amygdala as sort of a primitive alligator brain, the reptilian brain. And, you know, before we had a cortex, we had the amygdala, and the basolateral amygdala is kind of like a mini cortex. I mean, no laminar structure, but 90% glutamatergic pyramidal neurons. Associative memories can be formed here. Oops. And, I'll just say the central medial nucleus is largely GABAergic medium spiny neurons, like the striatum. So we know a lot about the basolateral amygdala at this point. There's been a lot of beautiful work done. And we know that neurons in the basolateral amygdala encode positive and negative valence in a partially non-overlapping manner. We know that sensory information converges onto, from of all modalities, onto the basolateral amygdala, that allows us to do both types of conditioning, a conditioned stimulus that might be an auditory tone, or unconditioned stimuli that might be gustatory, somatosensory, or nociceptive. And we also know that learning induces plasticity, specifically in this synapse, in the synapse that carries information about initially neutral information. Okay, so just really quick, I'll say that AMPA to NMDA ratio is a proxy for glutamatergic synaptic strength, and I'll talk a little bit more about this, but I'll just say that much. And we know that after fear conditioning, AMPA to NMDA ratio is increased, and we've seen that in a couple of studies from both Rick Huguenier and Roberto Malino's lab. And in this putative synapse, that this thalamo-amygdala synapse. And as a graduate student, I found that if you look at the same synapse and you train animals on reward conditioning, you also see an increase in AMPA to NMDA ratio in the synapse. And so at my very first conference, the Amygdala Gordon Conference, I gave a talk about this, one of these 10-minute talks, and I was greeted with sort of like borderline rage and confusion. How is it possible that, you know, the same mechanism can underlie fear and reward learning, reward conditioning? And this is at a meeting where it's 95% people studying fear conditioning. I think that was one of two reward talks. And so I was like, oh, I don't know. And then, you know, I had all these nightmares about, about this question. And, you know, it really comes down to a couple of different possibilities. One, maybe the amygdala just encodes salience. Anything good or bad would be represented here. Or maybe the amygdala is the site of valence assignment via distinct projections. Okay, Daniel? Are you back there? Can you skip to slide 49, please? Because we're just running a little behind today. Thank you. So I'm just going to summarize a bunch of old work. First, we know that opposite synaptic changes map onto projection. So after fear conditioning, you will see increased AMPA to NMDA ratio onto CEM projectors, which has been previously shown to be an output for fear expression. And after reward conditioning, we see synaptic strengthening onto BLA to NAC projectors. So the hypothesis was essentially this, that there is this divergence, that there are these projections that have positive or negative valence, and that synapses onto either projection would be strengthened. And that's what we found. This is all published, so if you're interested in the details, happy to show you or check it out. Oops. Also, we found that if you just get rid of all the inputs, shortcut everything, and optogenetically activate these two populations of basolateral amygdalas, neurons going to the central medial nucleus or the nucleus accumbens, you will be able to drive either avoidance or approach. And then we found that the inhibition, so we then photo-inhibited both of these populations with the hypothesis that hyperpolarizing these neurons would block NMDA receptor-dependent LTP. And what part of the hypothesis was correct, that if we silence these CEM projectors, that we would be able to impair fear conditioning. That is what I expected. I also expected, and I was wrong, that if we inhibited BLA to NAC projectors, we would impair reward conditioning. But that's not what happened. What we found was that inhibiting the CEM projectors did everything. It both impaired fear conditioning and enhanced reward conditioning, while manipulating BLA to NAC projectors didn't do anything. And so this was our first clue that things are not perfectly symmetrical in the basolateral amygdala. And so I'll come back to this, but what does this do in vivo? So this is what we figured out through some optogenetic experiments and some synaptic physiology. And so we wanted to come back to, we know the basolateral amygdala is the site of divergence, but how is valence expressed in vivo when the animal is actually behaving? And so we determined this is pretty basic, but just when I say valence coding, what do I mean? What are the criteria? And it boils down to a few very simple criteria. One, really obviously, it's got to be task responsive. And so here, sorry, I should have said, I'm showing you in green the responses to a rewarding CS, which could be inhibited, no response, or excited, and the same for a response to a punishment-predicting condition stimulus. So really what we are looking for is differential responding. If we see similar responses to both types of stimuli, this suggests it's a salience neuron. And we want to know that things are independent of stimulus features, meaning, you know, it's not just tracking sensory modality or something. And so Anna Baylor in my lab, this is the time before neural pixels probes, recorded 1,600 neurons in the basolateral amygdala photo-tagging or photo-identifying three different projections, the two I've talked about and also the BLA projection to the ventral hippocampus. I don't have time to talk about any of that work today, but we've shown that that projection is important for anxiety, not learning and memory per se, but sort of innate states. And so if we don't, if we just look at the basolateral amygdala responses overall, we get the same thing that other people have gotten, which is that there's some neurons that encode for the reward CS, some neurons that encode for the fear CS, the punishment CS, and some that, a lot that don't care, some that do both, a mixed bag. And this is a head-fixed task of discrimination. And what we found is that the basolateral amygdala projection to the nucleus accumbens predominantly encodes positive valence, while the central amygdala projecting population predominantly encodes negative valence. It's not homogeneous, it's definitely heterogeneous, but if you look at within cell differences, you can see this bias. So this is each cell's response to both and the different score, as well as if you look at all the units together, you can see that the BLA overall is 50-50, but the accumbens projectors and the CEM projectors each have a positive or negative valence bias. Okay, so this is just a movie of a cleared brain. Sorry that the BLA to central amygdala projectors are blue instead of red. But you can see here that there is a gradient, but that these cells are really largely intermingled in something of a salt and pepper. They're almost hugging each other. And so why would things be intermingled? I mean, you know, if you have information about positive valence information and negative valence information, why does it make sense to pour it all together and mix it all up and then, you know, just have to separate it again? And so I guess the assumption is that, well, things are together and that's why we have microcircuits so that they can interact. And so we thought there might be some possible different connectivity. There could be mutual inhibition, there could be unidirectional inhibition, or there could be sort of a neutral excitatory relationship because the amygdala has been known to be epileptogenic. And so actually both projections exist, like feed-forward inhibition as well as monosynaptic excitatory. But what we found was it actually seems more like it might be asymmetrical, which is not something I thought was possible. I just put it there because it's like literally another possibility. But here I'm showing you just the gradient of the intermingled neurons. And what we did was that we photo tagged each of these populations. And on the top row here, you can see, do I know how to use this? No, I don't. So the top row here, you can see our CTR2 expressing neurons that are photo-tagged with a short latency. Right below them are photo-excited neurons. There's a slower response. These are like in-network neurons. And then even below them are the photo-inhibited neurons. And you'll notice, if you look at the number of units, that this is a very large number. So when we look at each projection normalized to expression level, for each of these three projections, you can see that BLA to central amygdala projections are dominating. They have a very powerful ability to silence everyone else. They're like the wet blanket of the amygdala. BLA to nucleus accumbens, maybe it makes sense they didn't do anything because, you know, here they are, pretty wimpy in terms of their local influence. And so this imbalance between central amygdala projectors and nucleus accumbens projectors, to me, was not expected, but maybe it makes sense. It makes sense that, and you know, there's some patching data I can't show you right now, but the nucleus accumbens projectors and the central amygdala projectors have this asymmetric relationship. BLA neurons that projected the nucleus accumbens, marked N here, that's just short, they will actually excite CEM projectors, whereas CEM projectors will inhibit BLA NAC projectors. And this was super weird. We did this experiment a couple times, but that's basically what it boils down to. And I think the idea is that if animals are engaging in something rewarding, mating, drinking water, eating, and then a predator comes, they need to drop everything that they're doing and escape the predator because the predator is going to represent a much more immediate threat to survival. So I speculate that this asymmetry exists because it's very adaptive to err on the side of caution. And so this seems kind of obvious, or intuitive, but this is a very key piece of the logical proof. Because how can we have one trial learning if there isn't a baseline? You know, it's got to be set. So this tells us that the railroad tracks are default to negative valence. Because you know what? If something happens and I don't know what it is, if there's, you know, one time someone threw me a surprise party, and I was like, I was super scared until I was like, whoa, okay, no, it's friends, it's a party for me, this is good, all right? But you know, the initial response, it's adaptive for it to be negative. Okay, so how is valence expressed? There is this bias. These neurons interact with each other very dynamically, and it makes sense. We want to do action selection. We can't like eat, mate, and run from this predator at the same time. So it makes sense, and that's kind of this key piece of the puzzle, that we have a default state, and then we need a signal to gate reward learning when it's safe, when there's rewards around. That's what we're thinking about. And so this is, this is sort of, again, this key question. How do synapses know which neurons are which, right? We know that, okay, synaptic plasticity is coming onto this projection or this projection, but, like, how does that happen? Is there, like, a name tag? You know, there's information about the auditory stimulus, but that's going to go everywhere because we don't know if it's good or bad yet, you know, in our hardwiring. And then what is the signal that binds this plasticity and makes it specific down one pathway? So this is the valence assignment problem. So I'm showing you some work from just a review looking at both Hebbian LTP and spike timing dependent plasticity. We are again talking about tens of milliseconds, hundreds of milliseconds. Even if you do, you know, Jeff McGee's fancy calcium plasticity, it's still hundreds of milliseconds. And that doesn't explain, like, you know, reward conditioning or the classic fear conditioning, which is one of the most studied paradigms in neuroscience. It's typically 10 or 20 seconds between the onset of the cue and the delivery of the shock. And during that time, in graduate school, I found that the cue goes on, the BLA cares for a few hundred milliseconds, and then it kind of goes back down. Some cells have a little bit of sustained action, but like not really. Mostly it goes back down and where is the representation of the ongoing sustained state of reward or fear? How do we, what is connecting these events that are kind of far apart in time? So the idea is back to this neuromodulatory gain concept. Maybe we can kill two birds with one stone. We can both excite and suppress different populations with the release of a single neuromodulator or neuropeptide. And we can extend those timescales to span seconds or minutes. And maybe this could be the solution to the to the valence assignment problem. Okay, so way back in the day, Praneeth Namburi and Anna Baylor, they performed this work, and we did some RNA-seq transcriptomic profiling of these two different populations, just bulk-seq. And we didn't really know what we were looking for. We were just looking for, I guess I was looking for surface receptors, something that would be on the membrane. And we really focused in on the neurotensin 1 receptor, which is shown here. And you can see that there's a differential expression on BLA-CM and BLA-NAC predictors. Okay. So one of my colleagues said to me, Kay, if you did some RNA-seq, got a bunch of hits, pulled one, like cherry-picked one out of them, did some experiments, and they worked, you would be like the luckiest person on the planet. Like, that's just never happens. But it wasn't totally random that we picked this cherry. There's a couple of key reasons. One, the NTSR1 controls expression of a G-protein-coupled surface receptor, which made it unique in our short list of candidates. It's also been linked to both LTP in the BLA and contextual fear conditioning. And then most importantly, very serendipitously, and this is, you know, how science works, when I was in graduate school, I sat next to another graduate student named Kimberly Kempadu. And one of the very frustrating drags was like, oh, she's trying to get a paper in. This really annoying reviewer's comment wanted her to do this dose-dependent curve of all these different doses of neurotensin. And it was actually really a great experiment. Good job, reviewer, because different doses had opposite effects. At one dose, you have an enhancement, a facilitation of glutamatergic synaptic transmission. And at another dose of the same thing, you have a suppression. So for me, this was like, bah, bah, bah. Oh my God, this is the answer, because you could imagine that if there are different expression levels of the receptor, then one dose would turn one population on and turn one population off, basically, right? This could be the switch operator of the railroad tracks. Oh, and then, so thank goodness, okay, this project started when I was at MIT, and then we moved, and you know, when, I don't know anyone else who's moved, but a lot of batons can get dropped, and Hao Li came to my lab at the Salk, you know, less than 4 years ago, and picked this baton up off the floor, and is already, and you know, this is not a picture actually from like many years ago from when he joined my lab. This is current lab website picture. He's aged very well. But Howley is incredible, and the work I'm going to focus on today is his, and he just started his new job about 3 weeks ago. This is, again, the work of Hao Li, Praneeth Nemburi, and Jacob Olson. So we wanted to think about neurotensin. Okay, yeah, like, how does neurotensin even get to the BLA? Let's, like, do some tracing experiments. Let's look around. And so we found a few different upstream sites of the basolateral amygdala that have neurotensin and provide that input, co-localizing, you know, neurotensin-positive neurons and inputs to the BLA. And we basically tested all of these projections to see which one was important. I'm not going to show you that. There's a lot of experiments I'm not going to show you. But then we looked projection specific. And so I should also mention that all three of these projections not only release neurotensin, but they co-release glutamate, which makes sense since neurotensin is going to be modulating how the glutamatergic signal is processed. But the tricky thing is that, you know, these cells are releasing two things. And so we wanted to do some projection-specific CRISPR knockdown of the actual neurotensin gene. So we knocked down neurotensin, and what we found was that we impaired reward learning and enhanced punishment learning. Sorry, I'm going to switch back and forth between fear and punishment. I feel very agnostic about this. If you feel strongly, just like put whatever one that you feel comfortable with. I keep saying fear conditioning because I don't know. I just do. Just replace, self-replace. So what we found here was this opposite effect. So we know that neurotensin is necessary in this projection. If we now do a gain of function, albeit the caveat is that when we stimulate with channel rhodopsin, we're going to release glutamate and neurotensin. But when we do a channel rhodopsin photostimulation of neurotensin-expressing terminals in the BLA, we get the opposite. We get a gain of function, an enhancement of reward conditioning, and an impairment of punishment conditioning. So this suggests that neurotensin could be this gate and this switch operator. But let's be sure. Let's see what's really going on in vivo. And so we did this in two ways. I do want to say that this paper, I know this is published, but it took so long to get published that I feel entitled to talk about it longer. From when it was first submitted to when it was accepted, it was 4 years. Yep, 4 years. I know that's like a record. Partially our fault, we moved, there's a pandemic, but also this reviewer. So this reviewer, you know, basically, I think, you know, there's a lot of backstory, but basically suggested that we invent a lot of new technologies to get our paper revised, and we did. So this one's not a new technology. This is just terminal photometry, but bulk calcium signals. We wanted to look at bulk calcium signals of NT-expressing terminals in the BLA during behavior, and this is just GCAMP. And so what we got was we're doing a behavior, it's head fixed, there's either anticipatory licks to a condition cue that predicts sucrose delivery, or there's another cue that predicts an air puff to the eye, and we're looking at eye blink. And so what we got is that in vivo, the bulk photometry signal, we see more fluorescence when there's upon reward conditioning, and a reduction in this signal with punishment conditioning. But I agree that this is like got a caveat that, you know, it could be, is this activity related to glutamate release or neurotensin release? We don't know. And so one of the great suggestions from this reviewer is to create a neurotensin sensor and then use it. And so thank goodness for Yulong Lee, because I was never going to make a sensor by myself. But Yulong Lee came in on this white horse with this neurotensin sensor that just worked. And so the grab and neurotensin sensor, and there's newer versions of this that work even better, but you can see here is super specific for detecting neurotensin, not glutamate or anything else. And we put this into the basolateral amygdala, and we got the same result, essentially, as the photometry. The signals look different, but the general phenomenon of the signal being increased with reward learning or across reward learning and decreased across punishment learning was also still there. Okay, so just to summarize, we know that neurotensin in this specific projection from the PVG, the BLA, is both necessary and sufficient to drive valence assignment, and that it gates reward conditioning and suppresses punishment or fear conditioning. But is it that simple? Like, you know, is this the new reward juice? Is neurotensin gonna, you know, be the answer to everything? Exactly what does it look like if neurotensin's not there? What does the brain look like? And so we wanted to know how neurotensin could influence dynamic representations. And so another very challenging experiment that took us many attempts to succeed to do. But once in a while, the stars align, and credit goes to Hao Li. Many, many people attempted this experiment, and Hao is the one who actually pulled it off. So first, we did projection-specific CRISPR, injected the Cas9 to the PVT, and then using a retro AV, expressed the neurotensin-specific guide, or the scrambled control, into the basal lateral amygdala. And then we expressed channel rhodopsin and a retrograde virus, a dual virus approach to selectively target either BLA to NAC or BLA to CEM, central amygdala. Okay, so this is a busy slide. I know it's a lot, but what I want you to take away from this is, number one, that there are a lot of different responses. They are very diverse. And so what I'm showing you are heat maps of sucrose, neutral's cue, or the shock condition stimulus. I'm going to show you a bunch of hierarchical clustering plots like this. I love looking at the raw data. I know not everybody does, but I love staring at this. Anyways, the one thing that really jumped out to us is that no matter what the cells do, whether they were inhibited or excited or selective to one thing or not selective to another thing, when you CRISPR out neurotensin, it reduces the amplitude of every response across the board. That was the thing that we saw, which was not, you know, like totally consistent with this idea of reward juice, but is consistent with this idea that there's a push-pull action within the basolateral amygdala that we're modulating. Specifically for the projections, if you CRISPR out neurotensin, the bias that we previously saw is gone. And then if you look at the whole population, so this is a neural trajectory, and if you're not familiar with looking at neural trajectories, one good way to look at the population, so say I record from 1,000 neurons. How do we look at the activity of 1,000 neurons? There's a lot of different ways, but one way is to put the whole population together and plot it in 1,000-dimensional space, and every single neuron is a dimension, except for, like, you know, it's a lot hard to plot 1,000 dimensions onto a slide. So we've dimensionality reduced to two PCs, two principal components, and we're looking at each of those trajectories. So you can see that prior to the Q coming on, the baselines are right on top of each other. Q comes on, and then bifurcation, right? Sucrose goes here, shock goes here, neutral goes in the middle. If you CRISPR out neurotensin, it looks like this little blob. I had to blow it up because it just looks like a black dots, but it shrivels up that representation to a little tiny thing. Okay, I'm gonna skip this one for the interest of time. And so loss of neurotensin in this projection, the PVT to the BLA, increases passive behaviors. And what I mean by that is not all approach and not all defensive behaviors are the same. So what we wanted to look at is the behavior, and so Anish Ball, who's now a graduate student at Johns Hopkins, used a watershed density-based clustering approach to look at all the behaviors. So on sucrose trials and on shock trials. And basically, we categorized the behaviors that we got in terms of active or passive. So freezing would be a very passive defensive response, whereas darting would be an active defensive response. And so this is coming from these specific different behaviors. And then when you pull it apart to look at what part of the cluster came from CRISPR, the animals that had neurotransin CRISPR'd out versus the controls, you can see that here, and it's really dramatic that the control animals have a lot more active responses, and what we're losing is them, and then it becomes much more passive responses. But without neurotransin, animals can discriminate, but everything's just muted. Okay, so this kind of takes us back to the big question. All right, what do we have all together in the field? This is incorporating everything now, not just, you know, amygdala specific work. This is the whole brain. So let's just think about fear conditioning, which, you know, at this point we should really understand, you would think, right? It's like really, really well studied phenomenon. And there's so many people working on it. And there's like multiple meetings where all they talk about is fear conditioning. And yet there's like some really big holes or some elephants in the room that nobody wants to talk about. So I'm gonna talk about it. So there's this mouse, say there's a mouse and there's a bobcat. So there's this threat stimulus for whenever there's a CS related bobcat. Maybe it's a sight, maybe it's a smell, whatever. Maybe smells innate, so let's say some other cue. So there's some information that there's a potential threat nearby. Maybe a twig snaps, there's some rustling, who knows. And the entire duration of the threat, but the amygdala signals the onset of threats, largely. It's not like screaming on, flipped on the whole time. What we don't have is, you know, something that's rapidly responding, that has sparse coding, that stays excited for the duration of the internal state, like however long the mouse is quote unquote scared, we would need something to code for that, right? But where is that thing? And we know the motor activity, yeah, like there's motor cortex, there's striatal outputs, that part we kind of have figured out, you know, when we get to behavior. But from going from stimulus to response, there's this major hole in the middle. That I think is a very important missing piece. And so this is more of a teaser than anything else. This project is still undergoing some final touches, but this is the work of Fergal Mills. And Fergal Mills is an incredible postdoc who's on the job market, although, you know, imminently, might have something to tweet about soon. And what he's shown is that amygdala striatal transition zone, this like brain region that I previously only thought was important for sticking I just thought of it as the internal capsule. This is where I stick my electrode. This is the part I chop off. You know, it's kind of this unturned rock right next to everything else. It's just nestled right in between the central and basolateral amygdala. And we think this might be a key. Oh, and this is Fergal's little avatar, because he really likes pink boas and the color pink. And so that's why the AST is pink here. And you can see we put some neural pixel probes right through, and we can record from the tail of the striatum, the amygdala striatal transition zone, and the central amygdala. Oh, I see the time. Okay. Yes. And so what we see in the amygdala striatal transition zone is indeed this very first cluster, these screaming responses that are sustained and high. And this is not seen in the central amygdala or the tail of the striatum. Okay, so the other key thing is the amygdala striatal transition zone is representing sustained valence, not discrete motor outputs, meaning that if we look at freezing versus darting, it doesn't track that. What it tracks is the playing of the cue, the sustained valence. So I think perhaps the amygdala striatal transition zone could be this missing piece that we've been looking for. So once again, we've got this hole. And maybe the amygdala, the AST, is this solution. Okay, so I'll summarize here and think about all these motifs. I want to also say, you know, amygdala circuits, some of these questions that we're talking about are the simplest of questions. What is the difference between good or bad? You know, and if we can't understand these fundamental building blocks, how are we going to understand even more complex ones, like a lot of the other things that we're interested in? So this is a very well-conserved set of circuits, all the way from reptiles that have hardly changed 70 million years ago to us. Okay, So I want to pause there and stop with the science and just say, I love this meeting. It's my first time here, but when I walked in, I saw this sign, and it made me feel so seen. As a single mom, it is really incredible to see on-site childcare. Thank you for doing that. Thank you for doing that. Can we get some applause for the on-site childcare? Thank you so much. This is super important, actionable things that we can do to make meetings more inclusive and to patch that leaky pipeline, so to speak. The other thing I really felt warmed by was the sign about elevators, because stairs are my mortal enemy. And then I just want to tell one other story. I really am grateful to Sheena and Steve for their beautiful talks and then science, as well as their inspiring messages, which I totally echo. And I'll just say a quick story. Is that I was playing with Christy Towers, a new faculty at Salk, and her son and my son. We're all playing, we're talking, we're chopping it up. We've hung out a couple times, and my daughter buried them both in the sand, and then we're talking. All of a sudden, the boys turned to us and said, "Mom, can boys be scientists too?" And it just made me feel like, wow, stereotype threat is real. And, case in point. So it's all about our microenvironments and challenging stereotype threat. Representation absolutely matters. So with that, I'll just thank all of you for your attention and say we are recruiting. I do want to do a shout out for the amazing people in my lab. Anna Baylor, who started out this work. She's my first postdoc. She's now at Bordeaux working on the insular cortex and has tenure. My first graduate student is now faculty at UVA, an amazing mentor. He just started his lab. If you're interested in substance use disorders and quantitative methods, talk to Edward. Stephen Azier Alsop, now at Yale, is interested in observational learning and music therapy, doing it in a very rigorous quantitative way. Gwendolyn Calhoun at Bates and Ames Sutton at Temple both worked on how food deprivation changes circuits in the amygdala. Cody Siciliano is faculty at Vanderbilt and has had a thriving lab working on compulsive alcohol drinking. Nancy Padilla Coriano is now faculty at the University of Florida, my former postdoc. She started about a year ago, and she's a phenomenal mentor. If you're interested in social rank, you should reach out to Nancy. And then Eyal Kimchi, Hao Li, and Risha Patel, all worked in my lab for maybe about 3 years. They're just amazingly talented and are all starting labs at Northwestern, this year. And Tony Burgos Robles at UT San Antonio is also setting up new behavioral paradigms for all of this. And Fergal Mills and Austin Coley are pending. So stay tuned. I should be able to tweet about it soon. And look, there's the space for you. Does anyone want to do a postdoc in my lab? Because I've got some spots. And I just want to say, I know I was awkward at the poster session. I went up to someone and was like, "Hey, you want to do a postdoc?" But I don't know how to do it. So there we go. Thanks, everyone in my lab, all the funding sources, collaborators, and you for your attention. Happy to take any questions.